Grace and peace to you in the name of God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, and in whose spirit we worship this morning. The Lord be with you. Good morning and welcome to worship. It's good to see everyone in worship this morning on a beautiful Sunday. I'm Scott Griffin. I'm the pastor here. Wonderful to have you all in worship and be together as the family of God at Zion Church. I have a few announcements I want to go over with you. And of course, we always have a gift of presence card in our bulletins, if you wouldn't mind pulling that out and letting us know a record of your attendance. Some people have mentioned that there's a song that maybe we haven't had in a while, and a hymn or a contemporary song. You could also put that on there if you'd like, and we'll try to incorporate that into our worship. Feel free to write some information like that, a prayer request. We'd love to hear from you. We'll be dropping that off later on in the service. At the conclusion of the sermon, we'll walk forward and present our gift of presence card and our tithes and offerings in the offering plates a little bit later on in the service. If you're watching online, feel free to check in to Zion on your Facebook app or YouTube or the website. Let us know that you're here. We'd appreciate that. In your bulletin, you'll find some other announcements. One of those is that in the month of May, we'll be having communion the first Sunday of the month, and the altar rail for that communion service will go to Teen Challenge. I announced that some last week, so I'm sure you're aware of it at this point, but want to remind you, Teen Challenge is the May's altar rail. And then I want to remind you as well, go to the next slide, please. I can't see it from here. It was not your fault. That's my fault. If you're having an event here at the church, please get it on the calendar. We're noticing that as we're coming back to church, some things aren't showing up on the calendar. Even some of us who should have been putting it there didn't put it there, but that helps us know who's supposed to be here and what's going on. The last thing I want is to tell someone to go ahead and polish the floors and you're downstairs trying to have a birthday party. So be sure that things are on the calendar, even if you've called in. As you drop by, just look at the calendar, make sure it's there. Things are supposed to be there as we're learning to get back into the habit of the way we do things. The last announcement I have for you is a picture, a little slide I've made to show us that we're trying to make our track around 200 miles of pray, walk, listening. You may remember these cards from last week. We have plenty of them in the back still. Pray, walk, listen. This is a 6-mile radius around this church, and all the instructions about that are here. I will not tell you straight away who it was, but there has been one person that's reported 1 mile. 1 mile has been reported. I'm not saying you haven't done anything. It's possible that you haven't. It's a new habit, I understand, but we got 200 miles to go. There's been some concern that not everybody walks. Not everybody walks as far. We don't walk like we used to. I haven't figured it all out yet. I'm going to say it's okay if you drive, but your miles aren't going to count the same. I don't know what the deal is, but you can drive some. But the idea is to pray and listen and to be in that space for a while. So if you drive by, you're like, and you're collecting miles, but you're not really knowing what you're driving past. So spending some time, taking some time to pray and listen in the place that you don't normally go, that's in the 6-mile radius, and we're tracking that over the next few weeks and to see. And again, we're waiting till we've heard from the voice of the Lord. We've heard from the Spirit of the Lord as we prayed around in our community until we schedule our charge conference. So at this pace, it should only be 200 weeks from now. That was not on the original plan from the council that it would take that long. So please, please get out and pray, walk, listen in our community and start sending in those tabulations, and we'll watch these people on the track move a little bit further along the path as we go, okay? As we move forward in our worship this morning, we're going to stand together as Pam Johnson, our liturgist, leads us in our scriptural call to worship from the book of Isaiah. Let us stand together.
The sovereign Lord has given me his words of wisdom so that I know how to comfort the weary. The sovereign Lord has spoken to me, and I have listened. I have not rebelled or turned away. I offered my back to those who beat me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out my beard. I did not hide my face from mockery and spitting. Because the sovereign Lord helps me, I will not be disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like a stone, determined to do his will, and I know that I will not be put to shame. He who gives me justice is near. Who will dare to bring charges against me now? Where are my accusers? Let them appear.
See, the sovereign Lord is on my side. Who will declare me guilty?
This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God.
Let us remain standing for our next hymn. Last scripture said, the Sovereign Lord is on our side, and we're going to sing about that as we sing together, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. May be seated. This time the choir is going to come forward and sing for us a special. We look forward to their voices lifting us forward into the throne of grace.
We do.
Thank you, choir. And now we'll have a moment to recite the Apostles' Creed. Would you join me with the words on the screen? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, and the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. These are things that we believe, and we're proud of them, and it's what God has done for us. Another thing that God has done for us is washed us clean because of the blood of our Savior Jesus Christ, and we're going to sing about that as the band leads us in our next song.
Mercy, I am clean.
Would you join me in prayer? God, it is only by the power of your work and the effort of your work on the cross that we are made worthy. We are made worthy because of what you have done. And yet before that, before we were made worthy, you saw us as worthy enough to come and give yourself, don human flesh, give your life on the cross, shed your blood. Somehow, even before you made us worthy, you saw us as worthy, despite the sin that enwraps us, the things that we do wrong, the poor choices we make, the problems we cause, the mistake-prone nature that we have. You saw us as worthy, and then make us worthy. And we are only clean because of your efforts. And so we come each week to say thank you, to give you praise and glory, to lift up your name and praise you for where you found us, where you've taken us from as we've walked along the path hand in hand with you. You point out other ways that we can grow and improve in your midst and in the church, being obedient to your call. And as we pay attention and do those things, the commands, maybe they're personal, maybe they're biblical, as we do those things and incorporate that into our world, we find that we live a better and better life, that things come together better, even in the difficult times and the heartache that comes our way. Those are made easier to get through by your presence, by your comfort, grace, and peace that guides us. God, there are those who are going to be going through procedures in the coming days and weeks. There are those who are suffering from cancer or other debilitating concerns and diseases. We list so many in different forms in our prayer list in the back of our bulletin. We pray that you would minister to the point of each need in the way that they need to be met. Maybe some of our requests aren't in ink on our bulletin. Maybe we have yet to even talk about some of the things that are most important to us. We pray that you would, that all of us would lift them up to you, whatever the request is. Even if we're afraid to say it to anybody else, that we lift it up to you so that we can watch your hand move in our lives, especially in these most important areas. The kind of God that you are, we know that you can make a difference in those situations. Give us patience as we wait and watch to see what you will do. Lord, we lift up this season of the church, the Easter season, when we get to run around thinking about the fact that you overcame things that we can't overcome. That's the kind of power that you have. And that's the kind of people that we are. We walk around as Easter people, serving an overcoming God who not only overcomes but undertakes for each of our concerns. And that kind of resurrection victory can be made known in all of those difficult areas. Help us to walk away from worship each week empowered by your Spirit, knowing who we serve and who you are, that regardless of what we come across and what we're up against it with you. You set the path for our feet, and you overcome in areas that we can't understand. Help us to be a confident people, not only in the areas of our life where we need you because we can't do it for ourselves, but areas that you're guiding us as a church. Use us to be people in the world who proclaim that we serve a resurrection God. Maybe we proclaim that with our words. Maybe we proclaim that with our lifestyle. We want to be a light to the world, your light shining through us. We want to be a church that does just that. God, as we go out into this world and working on our pray, walk, listen, we pray that you do reveal to us incredible things of your Spirit. Help us to perceive things we've not yet perceived before, that we might be able to minister to those who come our way. We want to be a church ready to do your will. And I believe each week as we gather together, not only in worship but in small groups as well, I pray that you would stir our hearts and impassion us toward the lost in ways that maybe it's been a while. We certainly haven't been able to do the kinds of business of church that we can do in the near future. We thank you for impressing that upon us, but we pray that we would be ready and that you would use us to do something special in your kingdom right here at Zion. So we offer you the remainder of this service, all of these prayers in this moment, all of the songs that we've sung and will sing and the word to be proclaimed. May it bring joy to your heart, and may we grow because of it in your spirit. And we'll respond to you in the prayer that you taught your disciples to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we'll have our New Testament reading, which comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 14, as read by our liturgist.
Jesus was at Bethany, a guest of Simon the leper. While he was eating dinner, a woman came up carrying a bottle of very expensive perfume. Opening the bottle, she poured it on his head. Some of the guests became furious among themselves. That's criminal, a sheer waste. This perfume could have been sold for well over a year's wages and handed out to the poor. They swelled up in anger, nearly bursting with indignation over her. But Jesus said, Let her alone. Why are you giving her a hard time? She has just done something wonderfully significant for me. You will have the poor with you every day for the rest of your lives. Whenever you feel like it, you can do something for them. Not so with me. She did what she could when she could. She pre-anointed my body for burial, and you can be sure that wherever in the whole world the message is preached, what she did is going to be talked about admiringly. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
It is now time for children's time, and Donna Take is our children's leader this morning. And in the first service, she only had her granddaughter. I have a feeling that this one's going to be a little different. So kids, come on down.
Well, good morning. We are going to talk about road signs this morning. Has anybody ever seen this before? Yes. Does anybody know what it is? Yes. Is it a road sign? Okay. Stop light? Yes. Okay. Can somebody tell me what the red means right here? What is red?
Stop.
Okay. How about the yellow?
Go
slow. Yield. Those are good. Okay. Let's see. How about green? What does green mean? It means go, yes. And whatever speed, yes. Okay, those are all correct. So the reason we have road signs is to keep us safe. Because can you imagine if you were supposed to stop and you went instead and went go, you might have a wreck and get hurt. So these are things that make our life better, these signs that we follow. Do you know that God has given us signs to follow? Kind of the same thing. Only his, we kind of have a fancy word for it. It's called commandments. Yes? Did you have? That's perfect. I don't know if you heard that, but she says her grandma has signs on the refrigerator that look like road signs, but they say things like yield and about God. That's perfect. So we know that it's really important to have signs and commandments, and that commandments make our life better. Can anybody remember what is the most important commandment we have from God that makes our life better? Yes, Eve. That's one. How about the overall big one that we're all supposed to do all the time? Something about love. Anybody know what that might be? Yes? She said there's two. She got me. That's very good. Love your neighbor as yourself and love your God. So I want you to remember this week when you see a road sign to remember that God has commandments and signs for us to make life better. Okay, let's do a quick prayer. Ready? Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for all the commandments and help us to remember to love one another. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Donna. Thank you, kids, for participating. And I was afraid that we were going to hear a confession that somebody's grandma had stolen road signs. And you never know where it's going to go. So I have a confession this morning. A week ago, Friday, so about 10 days ago, 9 or 10 days ago, Lauren saw me lose my patience at after Walmart. It was my experience at Walmart that helped me to lose my patience, and there was a new guy involved. Sometimes the new guy doesn't always know what he's doing, or new girl, and it can help you to lose your patience. The specific story, my circumstance, it wasn't all the new guy's fault really at all, but he participated. I had intended to go into Walmart quickly on a Friday evening after 8 o'clock, grab something real quick, and get back out. I know how to do that. I do the self-checkout, and I do Walmart Pay on my phone, so I don't need to talk to anybody. I don't need to interact with anybody at all. I don't have to. I can. I'm not trying to be rude. I just need to get my stuff and get out of there. So I was going in real quick. I left Lauren in the car because I was going to be in and out real fast. I got my stuff. Well, first of all, I walked in the door that was closest to where I parked. That makes sense. So then I got my stuff, came back, and I was going back to the self-checkout area closest to that exit. And when I got over there, they had all these little signs on top of the self-checkout that said lane closed. Self-checkout, lane closed. If I show up, it should be open. I mean, I'm the one who's doing the work. So just plug it back in. What's the problem? You know, I don't know what's going on. So I looked down, and I'm like, the lines are usually going to be long in front of the checkers. So I kind of walked past them all, but my intention was to go all the way to the other end of self-checkout, get the job done, and walk all the way back if I had to, because I know what I'm doing. I'm trying to take care of my business. So I walk over there, and that line's really long. Well, of course it's long, because you closed all the ones over here. So I walk halfway back, and I see that there's somebody being checked out, and they've got a lot of stuff, and their basket's empty, but it's all on the conveyor belt. Well, it's only a matter of time. But the person, and I didn't know this till later, but the person who was the checker was new. I didn't know this till I got up there to pay myself, and he had a yellow jacket on, showing that he's a cart guy, not a checker. And he doesn't know what he's doing. So he looks a lot like me at the self-checkout. Of course, I know what I'm doing, you know, it's my two products, so I pick it up and I've got to flip it over 7 times, find the barcode, boop, 1, you know. And he's doing the same thing I am, except they've got a conveyor belt full of stuff, just every item. Mm-hmm. Boop. You want this in a bag? Every item. Every item. Of course they want it in a bag. They've got it in a conveyor belt. Just standing in line, waiting my turn. So they get finished. They actually have to stop and pay. Oh, that'll be our first purchase, and then this on the second purchase, of course. Of course. That's why I do the self-checkout, but I don't know why they're closed. In the meantime, Lauren texts me. She's like, I need to go to the bathroom. Should I come in? Yeah, come on. I could be here a while. So she's on her way in, as far as I know. They finish with their second purchase. I come up, 2 items, boop, boop, you know. You want these in the back? No need. And then I'm standing there with my phone because I do Walmart Pay, and all you got to do is have your phone. They have a QR code that comes up on their little screen, and it pays for it. It's an electric receipt. As soon as it accepts it, I do what I do, and then I walk away, and they're like, you need your receipt, and I don't need it because it doesn't even print it. It's already in my account. I'm ready to go. I know what I'm doing here. So he's looking at me a little crazy because I'm standing there not doing anything, and I said, I'm just waiting for the QR code to use Walmart Pay. And he goes, So he talks to luckily there was a lady right behind me. So he says, you know, what can we do about this? She comes around and go, oh, that ain't working right now. Of course not. So I said, I pay this way all the time. So I left my wallet in the car. I could go get it. At that point, the woman behind me goes, you got to be kidding me. So I said, no worry. Just take those 2 items off of that and I'll come back in a moment and pay. And you know, you can move on with her. And, he goes, because he doesn't know how to get him off. He was new. He didn't know what he's doing. He's doing his best. He was the cart guy. They pulled him out of the bullpen, you know, bring in the cart guy, have another checker. I don't know what was going on. Later on, I realized that it's probably still COVID protocol because here comes Lauren in to use the restroom, and she's coming from the... why did you circumnavigate Walmart to get in to use the bathroom? What are you doing coming in from... They locked the door. It's 8:30 on a Friday. Why are they locking the door? I mean, you're going to have 1,000 more customers before the day's out. And so I'm thinking it's COVID protocol. But I didn't know that. I was just starting to pull my hair out. You're closing down your self-checkers. You're closing down your doors. Your stuff doesn't work. At any moment, I've been here for 10 minutes. This should have taken me two. You could have said an announcement. Hey, our Walmart Pay isn't working. We're now closing our south entrance. Nothing. So I'm pulling my hair out. She uses the restroom. We get back in the car, and she listens to me complain about it. All the way to Dollar General, where I can finally buy my products. And I walk in, and he says, we're closing in 5 minutes. And I just said, I'll be out in three. And I was, and it worked out. But that she lost, saw me lose my cool. And some of that had to do with the new guy. He didn't know it. It's not his fault. We need to be patient with people when they're new. If you're not going to be patient, then just get out of line. New guy, I'll go back over here. And just get out of line. It's okay. They don't know any better. But if you're not ready for them, and I wasn't ready. I came in with expectations to get in and out, that all of the equipment would work exactly the way I had imagined in my mind that I was going to make this happen quickly. There was a few things that Walmart threw me some roadblocks, but really it was my expectation that didn't get met, and I was frustrated. And it's easy to be frustrated with new people when they're new and they're checking you out of a retail store and they don't know how to fold your clothes correctly or don't know how to work the equipment. When you're training people in the workplace, sometimes it's hard working with new people. It's hard no matter what is new to us. I remember a movie from the 80s, Mr. Mom. You guys remember that movie? If you've not seen it, it's only been out there for 40 years. I'm going to do some spoilers, but that's really on you. I mean, 40 years of a movie being out there, give or take. So Mr. Mom, the movie is... Michael Keaton is playing the role of the dad in the family, and he is working in a car manufacturing plant, and he loses his job. And his wife, though, has a degree, and she's been a stay-at-home mom, and so she's like, well, maybe I'll go see what I can do to make money for the family. And so they switch jobs. She's fairly well prepared to go into the working world, but he's not very well prepared to be the mom. He doesn't do a very good job, especially at the beginning. He feeds the baby chili. That doesn't go well. He's making grilled cheese sandwiches with an iron on the ironing board in the kitchen, squeezing that in between, you know, shirts that he's doing. So he's figuring things out as a dad, and he's muddling his way through. They both have a little bit of that. And at the very end of the movie, they're both proficient in the tasks that they perform. And then they're able to go back to their jobs. Everything works out. She'd rather be a stay-at-home mom, and he'd rather be back at work. But they both realize they could do a good job. Before that, though, when he's still a new dad doing the Mr. Mom thing, still trying to figure things out. He's on his way to school, dropping the kids off to school for the first day. It's raining on that day, and he's driving in, and his oldest son says, Dad, you're doing it wrong. Doing what wrong? What are you talking about? This is not how you do it, Dad. You're doing it wrong. I'm pulling right up to school. You're going to get out. It's no big deal. So he pulls up, and in this scene where you see this little picture here, he's rolling down his window, getting ready to talk to somebody, but it's raining, so it's kind of half rolled down, and as soon as he rolls down his window, it pulls up. This woman comes up on the screen, and she says, hi, Jack, I'm Annette. You're doing it wrong, just like his kids said. What do you mean? And we drop off on going south, and we pick up going north. You're kind of coming at it the wrong direction. And so, you know, that was new. Everybody else knew what to do. All the moms knew how to drop off their kids, but he's new at this, and no one told him. So he was doing it wrong. Being new is tough. Later on in the movie, though, we see him actually taking on this role that he was doing wrong, and here he is in a jacket and a cap, and he's taking on the role very seriously. And, you know, rather than just standing out there with an umbrella like Annette was doing, he's got the whistle, and he's doing it. You're coming through, now it's your turn. He's doing this stuff. He catches somebody else, and they're doing it wrong, and he goes, we pick up on the north, drop off on the south. Pick it up for next time, all right, buddy? And, you know, he's got it all down, giving him the routine and how to do it. But when you're new, you don't have it all figured out. Being new is tough. Whether it's the checkout guy at Walmart or being a new mom, anything. And being new reminds me of the woman in the story with Jesus that Pam read to us a moment ago. She was new and she was doing it all wrong. All wrong. I mean, what did she think she was doing anyway? At dinner of all places. First of all, where did she get that expensive perfume? Based on her reputation, she probably came by it via some sinful means, you know what I'm saying? Then, as if the moment was about her, she pours it on Jesus' head, like mid-conversation. Talk about awkward. Of course all the guests were furious. Who wouldn't be? This is impetuous and rude, especially to the host, Simon. She didn't say, hey, Simon, I'd like to do something nice for Jesus. Would be a moment in the meal that I could break away and do this. There's no no propriety that she offered. That must be why she said in the text, why they said of her in the text, they swelled up in anger, nearly bursting with indignation over her. Not to mention, she could have sold her ill-gotten perfume for money to be given to the poor. That's what reputable people would have done. She's new and obviously doesn't know that, doesn't get it. And while all of that is true, that's not how Jesus treated her. That's not how Jesus interacted with her at all. Several weeks ago, maybe even months ago now, we started worshiping more and more in person and less of us worshiping online. I remember one Monday morning after having more people in the building than we've had in about a year, walking out of my office and looking at the floor, and the sun was coming in early in the morning and the sun was gleaming off the tile floor, well, at least in parts. We'd had some snowy weather and some salt, and some of the wetness had come in and melted and dried, and some of the salt had melted in that, and there were footprints going in every direction, and then there was walker and cart tracks on top of those, and the bottom line is the floor was just filthy. But I couldn't help thinking how cool it was to have that problem again, that people had been here, that we're back in the churching business, that things, I was just appreciating that the floor was filthy and needed to be cleaned up, even to a lesser degree than what we've always done in the past. It was good to be back doing church again and seeing everybody again. And you got to admit, the Church of Jesus Christ is a pretty good place to get cleaned up. Now from our text, Jesus isn't concerned about the outward appearance or the outward propriety of the woman, the improperness of how she handled things. He already knew she was troubled. He's just glad that she's come to him to address her troubles. He sees past all the filthiness that everyone else obviously notices and appreciates her willing and courageous heart. She is willing, but it does take a bunch of courage. It takes a bunch of courage to step into an area that you're unfamiliar and to be new. Last week, I told a fictional story about a family putting a green light bulb out on their porch, and they would have folks come by. If the green light was on, you could come by, and the family that lived there would pray for them for physical healing. And that would end up being, you know, folks that come by that they didn't even know. They'd pray for physical healing for perfect strangers. And I asked, what might happen? And you all gave me some good, positive answers as to what might take place. But let me tell you what is assured that will happen if you were to do something like that. I want to tell you what is assured to happen by telling you another story. A district superintendent that I had in my past, he was giving an inspirational talk to a group of us pastors, and in the history of this man's ministry in the state of Washington in the Pacific Northwest, he was known to have healing services where remarkable and inexplicable events would take place. People would often want to hear examples of his ministry and hear some of the miraculous things that took place. He began this particular talk by making a subpoint that's often overlooked. He said, "Be careful when you advertise a healing service." Then he went on for a while to say anything and everything, including hospitality aspects you want to include in a healing service and what happens if things happen, unexpected circumstances. So he went on talking about all of that except for why you need to be careful. But then he came back and said it again. Be careful when you advertise a healing service. Then he got really close to answering the question, but then got off on another tangent. Interesting to us, though it was. Finally, he said one last time, be careful when you advertise a healing service, because when you advertise a healing service, sick people show up. So what can you be assured of if that family, that fictional family, puts a green light bulb on their porch? You can be assured of, if anyone shows, they'll be sick. Sick people show up. So in case you don't know this, the folks who might show for a healing service at a church, they will be sick. They won't even necessarily try to cover up the fact that they're sick. They're just sick. Let's say that that happened to us. Let's say that we, Zion as a church, advertised a healing service. Well, here would come the sick people in all their sickness, not necessarily knowing about their cough pocket. The last service really didn't show that they knew the cough pocket. You know what the cough pocket is? This is your cough pocket. You cough over here in your pocket. If you cough in your hands and then you introduce yourself, it's all over the place. Am I teaching people new things? Now, some of you knew this already. This is your cough pocket. Some sick people don't always know about their cough pocket. Bottom line, they need help. And maybe, just like many of the folks that Jesus came across, they're sick and need help in more areas than just physical health. Their ultimate problem is just like you and me. They need Jesus. But while they're here, because we'd advertised a healing service and they're sick, so they're coming to get healed, they're new to us. And they don't know how we like to do things and how we go about things, like take communion or the traditional way to approach the kneeler. They don't know that. I was really glad that somebody told that to me. My first Sunday here happened to be the first Sunday of the month where we do communion, and I was doing communion, and I had heard that you come along this side and exit that way. But then I asked people to come forward, people stand, and someone dutifully stands up and leaves. New people don't know that. I was new. It was still interesting. I was like, is he mad? Is he coming back? Did I do something wrong? We'll have to wait and see. Now they came in the other side. Okay, this is going to work out all right. But you're new. You don't know. What if you decided to come forward while everybody else went backwards? You would be new, and you would have done it wrong. They're new, and they wouldn't know any better. They don't even know how to treat the building. Now, this place has been here. The place that you're sitting in has been there for 144-plus years, and it doesn't just magically stay nice. But they don't know that. They may even act disrespectful as they come forward to the chancel area. Or maybe after this healing service, we have some food, and there's a luncheon later, and we're downstairs in the fellowship hall, and they're roughhousing a little bit more than we would ever do, and maybe the paint gets chipped and scratched. But they're new. They don't know any better. How do we interact with them on that? Now, those are all my words. That's my scenario, how it might apply to us and things that we need to go through. But that back to that DS at his conclusion, he went back and mentioned, but you go ahead and advertise that healing service. Just remember, sick people show up. Got to be prepared for people who need Jesus. When people who need Jesus gather at our door, as we discussed last week, that doesn't mean they know how to do what we do or why in the world we do it. They may look a lot like the woman we just read about, a woman who is doing her best to honor the Lord and opening herself up to ridicule. That takes courage. It takes a lot of courage to step into a place you don't understand. It takes courage that we can further encourage by doing what Jesus did when he met her right where she was. And that's how we need to meet people in our church who might come in and gather at our door. One of the ways that Jesus did this, to meet her right where she was, is by repudiating those who misunderstood the situation. He needed to elevate her station by alerting that these people didn't do it correctly. In verse 6, Jesus says, "Let her alone. Why are you giving her a hard time?" Then he honored her further in verse 9 by prophesying over her, something that is true to this day. "You can be sure," Jesus said, "that wherever in the whole world this message is preached, the gospel is preached, what she just did is going to be talked about admiringly." We're doing that today. Nearly 2,000 years later, we're talking about how she had the courage to move forward. What did she do? But bring her best, the best way she knew how, and gave it to Jesus. But she didn't do it right, complain the old line bystanders. When the gatherers at our door come infirmed by the sinfulness of the world, we cannot be the kind of place that first notices that they're doing it wrong. In this movie, she was actually very pleasant. She has a pleasant smile on her face. She was very helpful to Jack as he was trying to figure out what Mr. Momming was like. But it doesn't make any difference. We can't be first alerting the people who gather at our door that they're doing it wrong. We have to expect brokenness, sickness, and folks who need all manner of healing, because the world offers us the same opportunities to be just as broken and just as sick. We're just not as new to this place. Our methods at Zion are not more important than the people. Our history, while incredible and something to be proud of, our history is not more important to Jesus than the people who will gather at our door. And while our buildings are useful for folks to draw closer to God in Christ, they are not more important than the people who will use those structures. That's why I really don't like to call them buildings. I call them facilities. Facilities facilitate ministry. People will come in who don't know how to treat an old building or a new building, but they will be facilities that speak to the point of their need. So whether we build or whether we're just cleaning up what we have, it's all to God's glory to meet the needs of the people who gather at the door, who are just as broken as you and I were before we stepped in when we were new. Instead of noticing what people do wrong, we first celebrate what they do right. And if they're here to meet Jesus because They've heard he's here doing remarkable things, you know, like a healing service. Then we've got the most important piece right if they're here because they're here to meet Jesus. It's somewhere down the line after they've met Jesus at this place that we have the privilege of showing them why we do what we do and how God has used it down through the years and that they're joining in with that. Here's what God has done with generations before me and how they did this and how they did that and here's where this piece of land has functioned in this way and here's what's going on and now we're doing these things and you get to join in with this vast, beautiful history. What a joy and an awesome responsibility it is to share that with them. But it only comes after we've received them just as they are, as they gather at our door. And I do believe that that's going to happen. I do believe that we're the kind of place that the Spirit of God is made known and that people get a glimpse of God here that maybe they're not getting in other places. Not that we're in competition with other churches to any degree. We offer something beautiful in the kingdom as every other church does. And I think we offer a lot. And I think we should expect people to want to meet Jesus here. And when they come and they gather at our door, I don't have any reason to believe that we're going to be rude and ugly, but we certainly can't afford to be because we're here to be Christ-like. And how did Christ Jesus do it to this woman? He accepted her right where she was. She offered her best and he received it and moved her forward, brought her a station. She is someone who Jesus has immortalized in his word. To this day, she's being talked about. We don't know her name, but we know the best parts about her that brought her to the Lord. And that's exactly how we need to meet the people who come, who are gathered at our door. Have a little filthy appreciation. We've all been filthy, but some of us don't get appreciated. Let's appreciate what God brings us, whether it's dirty footsteps after a busy Sunday or people who come to meet Jesus and just don't know what we happen to know already. They're new. That's a beautiful thing. And we have so much to offer them because God offered us the same. Our closing hymn is called Are Ye Able? The hymn doesn't ask, are ye able to do this work that Jesus has done? But I want to ask you that today, to consider, are we able to be the kind of church to receive gatherers at the door in the Spirit of Christ? I believe that we are. I believe there are great days ahead for Zion. I believe we're going to come out of this time when we were used to wearing masks more often, and we're going to be moving into the community in ways maybe we haven't done in some time, in some years, or maybe never done before. Maybe it'll be new to us. If we're patient with others who are new, I have no reason to believe that God won't be patient with us as we do new things. I look forward to seeing what God does in the future years of this church by the attitudes that we have and the Christ-likeness that we'll show. Let's stand together and sing hymn 530, Are Ye Able?
Thank you.
Jesus Christ, who by his becoming human flesh gathered into one all things earthly and heavenly, fill you with the sweetness of inward peace and goodwill. May the Holy Spirit embolden you to tell people about it everywhere, and may the blessing of God Almighty continually impress upon us all the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus as Lord. Amen. You are dismissed. Have a great week, everyone.